How's everybody doing today? Can everybody hear me all right and see my screen okay? Your reminder email that you received an hour ago should have had a link in it for the guidebook for this particular session. If you did not get that already, I'm about to add a link to that in the chat box here for you. This is basically an ebook guide, and it's going to cover all the subjects that I will be talking about tonight. You could use it to follow along with during the course, or you could also just use it afterwards for reference. Can everybody hear me and see my screen okay? Right, we got at least a couple yeses here. All right, good. Clive and Stan and James, good to see you guys all tonight. You wait just another minute or two. Looks like we're still missing just a couple of people. Give them just another minute or two to show up, and then I will go ahead and get started. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and get started here, guys. Tonight I'm going to be talking about the website control panel, also known as cPanel. To reach the control panel on your website, all you have to do is start by typing in your domain name and then just simply type in a forward slash and the word cPanel after it. On most web servers, this will get you to the control panel that you are looking for here. If for any reason the cPanel does not actually forward you to where you want to go, you can also use the port 2082. Just type in a colon after your domain name and then the port number, and this will also take you to your control panel. Once you log into your control panel, as you can see, there are a lot of different icons and things that you can do here. I'm not going to be discussing all of them, but I am going to go through here and discuss some of the most important ones with you guys. The first thing that I'm going to talk about is going to be email accounts. You can typically, with most web hosts, you can use your control panel to create your own email accounts for your domain name. You can use these from within the control panel, or you can also load these accounts into an external email client, such as like Windows Live Mail, for example. Now, all you have to do to create an email account to start with is just type in the name that you want to go along with the email. If you wanted, you know, an email that said Ryan at your domain name, you would just simply type in the word Ryan here, and then you select the domain name that you want from your shared hosting account. Then just type in the passwords that you need and create your account. Once you have created your account, you'll see all the accounts listed down below. If you click on the More link over here, you'll get a little drop-down box that actually provides you with two more options. One of these options at the top here allows you to access your email directly through the control panel. This is a fairly simple web-based email program. It does do its intended purpose to check your email and to send email. But if you work with more than one of these email accounts at the same time, then you will typically find that it's really more of a pain than it's worth to go through the control panel to access all your different email accounts. If you would like to set up an email account in an email client such as Outlook or Windows Live Mail, just click on the Configure Email Client link to get started. Up at the top here, you can see that there are some applications already built for you and ready to go. You can download the specific configuration file right here under protocols that you want to use depending on the application. If your application is not listed here, or if you have any problems trying to use these protocols, come down here to the secure SSL settings. It says that these are the recommended settings to use over non-SSL. This is the information that you will actually punch into your email client down here. You have an incoming server and an outgoing server. You might also notice that there are port numbers to go along with these. The incoming server, however, has two port numbers that go along with it. One is for IMAP and one is for POP3. Now, if you're not familiar with the difference between these two, POP3 is a format that will simply download all the emails from your server, and then when you're viewing those emails in your email client, they will all show up, at least initially, as being unread. And then if you access your email account from another location, also using POP3, then those emails will still show up as all being unread. So POP3 does not coordinate with the server in terms of which emails you've read and even which emails you have deleted. Whatever you're doing on your email client is only happening on your email client and not actually affecting the emails that are on your real server. The other alternative is to use IMAP, and IMAP is actually what I prefer to use. And this is especially good if you access one email account from multiple computers. For example, if you have a cell phone where you access your email from, but then you may also access it from your computer, or maybe you even have partners where you guys work together to coordinate email support, for example. IMAP is the best way to go for that situation, because when you read an email off of one on one email client, it will update that on the server, and then if you access it from another computer, you will see that that email has been read. If you delete emails, it will remove them as well. So IMAP just simply coordinates the email application with your server and keeps everything up to date there. So this is typically the settings that I recommend to use, and also using IMAP. I will actually load up each of my different email accounts for each of my sites into Windows Live Mail, and then it will check all of those simultaneously for me and let me check and send email all from one single location. It makes it much, much easier to deal with if you are handling multiple email accounts at the same time. Next, I'm going to go on to databases. Now, there is a lot of information that you can learn about databases, and I will actually be diving into database usage a little bit more in the fourth session of this training program, where I start talking about PHP programming. I'm actually going to show you guys how to do some interactions with databases, save information, recall it, and all that good stuff. But tonight, I really just want to show you the basic groundwork of how you can mess with your databases and create them and edit information within them. Can you have multiple sites and use Microsoft Outlook but keep accounts separate? Yes, they are kind of separated. I guess it depends on the client that you use. I have not used Microsoft Outlook in a number of years. Stan, I've been using Windows Live Mail on Windows 7, and then on Windows 8, there is just simply Windows Mail. On those sites, you can load up multiple sites and keep them all separate. It loads all the emails in one central location with Windows Live Mail, for example, but then on the left-hand side of the page, you'll have each of your individual email accounts listed, and you can simply choose to go through those one at a time and check your emails instead of viewing the list of all of them at the same time. Let me know if that answered your question for you there, and you're welcome. I'll continue on with databases here. I'm going to start out by showing you guys in the databases link here how you can create a database on your website that you could then use later in a website script. This is extremely useful if you ever have to do a manual WordPress installation. You will actually have to go through and create your database manually first, and then when you install the WordPress software, it will ask you for your database information to complete the installation. So for people that need to do those manual WordPress installations, this particular process here is very important and something you may use on a regular basis. To start out with, what you want to do is create your database to begin with. To do that, all you have to do is simply provide it a name. You want to use a name that has not already been used elsewhere before. If you're creating multiple WordPress sites, I highly, highly recommend to use a separate database for each of your sites. Click on the Create Database button, and it will go ahead and get that set up for you. Now, there is more that you need to do. Click on the Go Back button to return to this database page. And if you, I have a lot of different websites on this. This is one of my shared hosting accounts that I'm that I have loaded up here for you guys. You can see right here, this is the database that I just created. Unlike the other ones, there is not a user set for it currently. When you first create a database, all you're doing is creating that database. And then if you try to use that database without going further, you will run into problems because there is no way to access that database yet. To do that, what you have to do is to insert a user into your database. Down here below where all the databases are listed, you can see the MySQL users right here. All you need to do is to add a new user. I typically like to use the same name for my user here that I have used for my database. I use the name test2, and I will also use that here as well. And this just makes it easier to remember, especially when you're trying to recall this information to enter into the settings of the WordPress installation script, for example. Now, with your WordPress user, you have to provide a password for it, and this is the password that is actually used to access your database. I'm just going to punch in a simple password here so I can show, oh sure, I haven't given it enough strength. Just so I can show you guys exactly how this works. Of course I'm messing this up. Okay, here we go. Create a new user. Once you have that information punched in, you can see that this has created the new user now with my password. You need to return back to the page one more time here. Now what you need to do is to actually assign this user to the database. Right here below where you created the user, where it says add user to database, simply select the user that you created and then select the database that you have created and click on the add button. Now once you have done this, it's going to bring up another page for you here where you need to set the privileges for this user. Now what this means is that when a website script is accessing your database using this user login information, these are the privileges that that user is allowed within the database. For most situations and for, you know, scripts like WordPress, for example, you will want to give them all privileges. But there are some other uses for creating users with less privileges for security purposes, for example. Certain privileges like drop, for example, this can be used to completely drop tables from your database. Delete is another one that could also be used to remove information from a database. So some people will choose to not allow these privileges for a database user. However, if you're using WordPress, you need to have all these selected because WordPress will use each of these in one way or another on the site. Once you have selected all the privileges and updated this, then your database is completely ready to go. You've created the database, you've created the user, and now you have added the user into the database and assigned privileges to that user. Now just to show you exactly what this has done, I'm going to go back into the databases here, but this time I'm going to be using this link called PHP MyAdmin, and this is actually going to take you to a database management page that you can then use. Over in the left-hand side of the page, you have your list of databases. I clicked on the one that I just created here, and as you can see that this is an empty database to begin with. If you want to create information within this database now, it is something that you can do through a website script, but just to show you a little bit of basic information about databases here, I'm just going to create a test table for you so you can see a quick example of how this actually works. So I'm going to name my test table here, and I'm going to use three columns. Now the columns that you are using is for specific amounts and pieces of information that you will be saving within this database. Each time you want to save information to a database, all you simply do is input a particular row of information into the database, and each row of information will then contain information for each of these columns that you have created. Now, up here at the top, I am simply going to give a name to each of the columns that I'm going to create. As you can see, I have put a letter T here in front of each of the names that I am actually wanting to name these as. I'm using this T here as a prefix simply because there are certain words that are not allowed to be used as column names. And if you accidentally use one of these words and don't realize it, it can cause major problems in your website scripts, and you may not really even realize exactly what has gone wrong. So the easiest way to avoid that problem from the get-go is to simply put a prefix on each of your column names that you are setting up. Now, I have set up three columns here. One I have called TID, one I have called TName, and the other one I have called TValue. Now, this is going to be a table that I am using to store fairly basic information. Under each column name, you can see that there is a type drop-down box. This type defines the type of information that will be saved for this column. There are a bunch of different options here. A large portion of them you will honestly probably never use or have a need to use. So I'm really just going to describe a couple of the most commonly used ones here for you guys tonight. To start out with, the int type is actually a whole number. It cannot be a decimal number. It must be a whole number. If you have decimals, there is another type specifically for decimals. Once you have selected a type, you need to specify a length for it. For the int, you are specifying how many numbers long that number is allowed to be. So just as an example, I will set this to a 7. This would give it a maximum value of 9,999,999, because that is the highest number that 7 numerals can count up to. Now, with the TName, I am actually going to be saving some type of text here. So I'm going to select this. It is a variable character type here. And what this actually means is that this is storing text for you, but it is doing it in a way to limit the amount of resources that is needed to store this information. And it does this by allowing you to set a length on it. You are giving a length for the number of characters as the maximum value for any information that is saved within this column. Now, for this one, I'm going to set this at 32. Over here for T value, I will set this as a longer number. I'm actually going to use 255. Now, if you want to store text that is longer than 255 characters, then you will actually want to use this text value right here, and then you don't specify a length for it. But for the purpose of this tutorial, I'm just going to use this particular type here. Now, if you want to have a default value for one of these particular columns, you can select down here under default, you select as defined, and then you can simply type in a default value. If you just wanted this to always be saved as default, unless you specified otherwise, then you would just type this in right here. I'm not going to set any default values for this tutorial here. Going down a little bit further, the next important part that you want to pay attention to is the index here. Now, for this main column that I have set up, this ID number, I am going to set this as my primary index. Now, what this means is that this is the primary column that is used by the database system to organize the rows that are here. I'm also going to check this auto increment box right here. And what this is going to do, since this column is a number, the auto increment will actually, every time I create a new row, it will automatically set the value for this column for me as a number, and then each new row that is added to the database will have a number that is counted one higher than the previous row that was entered. You can use this as an ID number. It helps with organization. It helps with when you're actually working with the database information through a website script. It can help you to recall the information easier, or to also save new information easier, or to make changes to your existing information. This is the basics of the information that you need to provide to create a database table. It's really not a lot of information that you need. You just name the column, you set a type, you set the value and the length if it is needed, and then you simply select your index in your auto increment column. One last thing that you need to pay attention to down here is the collation. Now this is going to actually be encoding for the information that is saved within your database. I always use the UTF-8 Unicode. This is basically a multilingual encoding format that can be used for pretty much any language. And this just ensures that the information that is saved in your database actually gets saved there. If you're using the wrong encoding and you try to type information in that's in a incorrect language from the encoding, then it can actually strip out some of that information and not completely save everything for you. Once you have set up all the information for your database table, just click on the Save button, and it will go ahead and save that for you. Now, as you can see, if I go to take a look at the table, it tells me that it is empty, but then it gives me the structure here that I have created for my table. So then, through a website script, for example, you could create a script that was storing and retrieving information from this database table, and you could use the tname as a way to store the name of the variable that you are trying to save, for example, and then you could use tvalue to store that information for you. Just as an example, I will call this tname example, and I will set the value as a test value. And going down to the next one, I'm going to call this one example 2, and I will just call it test value 2. Now I'm going to save these rows into the database just so you can see exactly how this works. Now as you can see, I never entered in any numbers previously for these TID numbers. These were automatically set for me because I set them as auto incrementing columns. And then the information that I have saved here has been stored under the appropriate columns. So now what I could do is have a website script that is looking to retrieve these values when it knows the names of the information that you have stored. So you could retrieve this information, maybe even allow it to be edited, and then resave the information into your database. Obviously, this is just a fairly basic example, but using these same techniques is really the basis for almost every website script that is in existence out there. So by learning this information and how to actually do this stuff yourself, you can eventually go on to create your own customized website scripts, especially once I get into the PHP tutorial and actually teach some coding to you guys in a couple weeks. After the databases, I am going to next show you guys how to run both backups and also how to manage the files that are on your website. Under here, under files, you can see that there is a backups link and then there is a file manager link. These are the two links that I'm going to be discussing tonight for you. To start out with, I'm going to show you how the site backups work. You go into the backups page here. As you can see at the very top, there is this section that says full backup. Download or generate a full website backup. Now, initially, for most people, this is probably what they will immediately look at and download this backup, and they will actually count on these backups to be able to restore their websites for them in the event that something goes wrong. But what most people don't realize is that this full backup right here cannot actually be restored through your website hosting control panel. You actually need access to the server administration, sometimes called WHM, if you have a dedicated or a VPS server, for example. But unless you have that additional access, if all you have is a shared hosting account, then these full backups can honestly be completely useless for you. You could reach the point where you need to restore one of these backups and discover that it's simply not going to work, or that you're going to have to contact your website host to actually get them to restore it for you. So what you want to do is to actually go further down the page here to the partial backups. The partial backups are the ones that you want to actually use to back up your website information, and also this will allow you to restore your websites in the event that something goes wrong. You can download the directory backup right here through this button. When you're downloading the entire home directory, what you're actually doing is you're not only backing up all the files that are on your website, but the home directory also includes all of your email accounts that are on the hosting account. So with this backup, you're not only saving your files, but you are also saving all of your emails as well. In addition to the files, you also need to ensure that you download a database backup, especially if you're using WordPress, for example. All of the important information that is contained within WordPress is actually stored in the database. A small amount of custom information is actually saved in the files for any given WordPress site. And honestly, the only files on a WordPress site that are different from one website to the next are any upload files that you may have done there, and then also the themes and the plugins that have been installed on the site. But beyond that, all the actual content for your WordPress sites, all of that is stored within your databases. So if you're missing the databases and only saving the files, then again, this is something else that can get you into trouble. So you need to ensure that you're getting both the home directory backup and the database backup. And then if you need to restore those, that can be done directly over here from this same page. Depending on what type of sites you run and how frequently you may update them, could actually determine the, public HTML is similar to the home directory through Bluehost there. Public HTML directory is actually the directory that contains all of the public files on your website. The public HTML directory will not actually contain all of your email account files, but it will contain all the files that are on your public website. So downloading a public HTML backup and then a database backup would be able to completely restore a WordPress site. But you would just want to make sure that you are also getting your emails saved. I'm not sure if they offer a separate option to do that, or if they actually do bundle that in with the public HTML directory backup. In addition to the backups, when it comes to dealing with files on your site, the other option that you can use is the file manager here. Okay, separate option for emails on Bluehost. That's good to know, Will. Thank you. The file manager is essentially the same thing as FTP access, for example. This is where you can go to remove files from your website, to change the permissions on files and folders, or to even upload new files. Now, through cPanel, when you open up the file manager, it gives you an option here to select a directory that you want to use. If you're just looking to work on a specific website, you can just select that website from the drop-down box here, and that will just direct you straight to the location that you are looking for. so you don't have to actually hunt through all of your sites. I'm going to go over here. On the left-hand side here, you can see that these are the folders that are listed on your site. Now, I am actually in the home directory right now over here on the left-hand side. And as you can see, if I click on the public HTML drop-down box here, there are a whole list of other folders within that, and a lot of these have .com stuck on to the end of it. Now, these sites are actually my add-on domains that are also linked with this website hosting account. So if you're looking to work with the primary domain name for your hosting account, those files will be located in just the public HTML folder. But then if you're working with an add-on domain, the public folder for those sites is actually these .com folders. For a WordPress site, for example, let me pull up one of these here that is a WordPress site. You have a couple of basic folders that you will see in all WordPress sites: WP Admin, WP Content, and WP Includes. So this is how you can tell that you are in the correct home directory for a WordPress site that you are looking at. If you're wanting to upload themes or plugins onto your site, or to edit any of that information or delete files, for example, all of that is done through the WP Content folder in your WordPress site. There is a folder for the plugins and there is a folder for the themes. As you can see, if I go into the plugins folder, for example, there is an individual folder then for each of the plugins that I have installed on this website. Now, having the folders listed here doesn't necessarily mean that these plugins are activated on the website, but they are going to be listed within WordPress, and then you can go into your WordPress site and choose whether to activate them or not. In addition to simply browsing around here, most of the actual features that you can do within File Manager are located up at the top here. There's a bunch of different buttons that will allow you to create new files, create new folders, copy files, move files. This is also where you can upload new files through the File Manager. However, if you're uploading a lot of files at one time, File Manager is typically not the best way to do it. It's actually best to use FTP for that purpose, and I will be going into FTP here in just a moment just to quickly show you that and show you how that works. One last thing within the File Manager here that is worth pointing out is the Change Permissions link up at the top here. A lot of times, if you are installing a website script or perhaps creating your own website script that is looking to be able to modify any physical files on the website, the permissions can actually affect whether or not those files can be edited through a script or not. So what you will do is you might have some installation scripts that will tell you, for example, you need to set the permissions on a folder to 755, or you may need to set it to 777 or 644. There's a whole bunch of different numbers that are used. As you can see here in this Change Permissions window, as I check and uncheck these boxes, it actually changes the numbers that are down here. Having all of the boxes checked is a permission of 777. And what this basically means is just that with a permission of 777, you're allowing the folders and the files that these permissions are being set for to be edited by website scripts. As a comparison, some people will say that you should set something to 744 or maybe even 644. This is more of a limited access to the files or the folders. And a lot of times this may be recommended as a permission to use for a configuration file, for example, that might contain passwords to log into your database, for example. But I mainly just wanted to show this to you guys so you know where it is and the basics of how it works. But don't actually go into your websites and try to play around with permissions of files and folders unless you have read something that specifically told you to do so for the installation, because you can actually mess up the way certain scripts are working by changing the permissions around. If nothing is broken already, then there's definitely not a need to go through and to try to change permissions around on your site. For people that do not want to use the file manager, for example, they can use an FTP program. Now, this FTP program right here is called Core FTP. I have also used Qt FTP. Actually have Qt FTP on a different computer of mine, and I use Core FTP on this particular computer. There are plenty of free FTP programs out there that you can use. You don't have to go and purchase one. Some of the better ones, though, you can get a free 30-day trial on them, for example, just to see, you know, what the difference is. But if you're not going to be using this on a daily basis, there really is not a need to have software that you have actually paid for. Now, the whole point of FTP is to simply be able to upload and download files back and forth. And it can upload a lot of files all at the same time. For example, let's say you were wanting to install a WordPress plugin that you downloaded, for example. You would go to the WP content and the plugins folder of your site. And let's say this screenshots folder right here was the plugin folder that I wanted. All you would have to do is select the folder and then click on this little over arrow right here, and it would upload that folder and all the files contained within that folder to my web server. And this is much, much easier and faster compared with using the file manager, for example. If you need to be uploading more than just a couple of files, or if your files are a really large file size, then FTP will execute those uploads for you much faster and also much more reliably. I can't tell you how many times in the past before I started using FTP, I would go into File Manager and try to upload a large file, and it would make it part of the way through it and then just die. And I'd have to sit there and retry it over and over and over again. You won't really run into that type of issue using FTP. It's just a much easier way and faster way to manage all the files on your site. Now, most FTP programs, they have features that are found in the file manager, for example. You can change permissions on files and folders. You can still delete and rename and copy and move and all that other stuff. In this particular FTP program, if I right-click on something here, as you can see, I have directory commands over here to make directories. I can also rename and delete. If I go down to properties here, this actually provides me with the permissions here that I was showing you in the file manager. This works in the exact same way. You just check or uncheck the boxes to give you the desired value for your permissions for the folder or the files that you're working with. There's really not a lot more to explain about FTP for you. It's really just used to transfer your files back and forth, but a lot of people are not familiar with it or how to use it and will often avoid it for that simple reason. So I just wanted to make sure that all of you guys actually knew how to use that because it can definitely make your life a lot easier in some specific situations. Now, the next thing that I want to talk about is domain names. On a hosting account, especially a shared hosting account like this, you will have both subdomains and add-on domains that you could potentially use. Now, a subdomain is going to work along with the main domain name that you are using. For example, if I were to create a subdomain for this Down Comforter Guide website right here, if I wanted to create a subdomain called demo, then it would be accessed by visiting demo.downcomforterguide.com. And this would essentially act like a completely separate website from downcomforterguide.com. I could have a completely separate copy of WordPress, for example, running on each of those websites, even though they are still located within the same domain name. But then on a shared hosting account, when you are using the add-on domains and putting more than one domain name on a single hosting account, what this is actually doing, it's creating a subdomain for your new domain name, but then when people try to access that domain name, it's not showing it as being a subdomain. It is actually redirecting behind the scenes to that subdomain name, and it's making it appear as though it is a completely separate standalone domain name. Now, the process to add these new add-on domains to your account, it's fairly straightforward. All you have to do is type in your domain name here. You assign a username for your account. The username can really be anything you want. This is a username that would be used to access the account both through cPanel and also through FTP. The username and the password that you provide here will work for both cPanel and FTP once you have set this up. And now the document route here, this applies to where the website is located in relation to the primary domain name that is on the account. Now, since you are using a main domain name for the account and then adding on these extra domains, as you can see down here, for example, these websites are being put into a folder by the name of the domain name, but these folders are actually located within the primary domain name of my website. And so when people visit this domain name, it's redirecting them to this location on my shared server, except nobody really realizes that this is taking place. It just shows you as being on this domain name, for example. So this is a system that can be used to add a bunch of different domains all onto one particular hosting account. As you can see, I have 3 pages worth of domain names on just this one particular shared hosting account. And this is actually an older account of mine that I have used for creating some affiliate websites. And so I still leave it on the shared server just simply because I don't want it on the same server as all of my other business sites. So I do keep a dedicated server for all of my business websites, but for my Amazon affiliate websites, I just put them on shared servers. I can put about 20 or 30 of them on one server, and then my hosting cost per website really drops to a very, very insignificant number doing it that way. So if you're only building sites that are making a couple dollars a month a piece, you can actually even profit that way by putting enough of these on the same account. Let's see, Stan is asking if a separate purpose domain versus a domain you want to point to the first domain. I take it you're referring to the add-on domains here that I was talking about, or are you referring, okay. What the add-on domain is doing is when you first set up your shared hosting account with a hosting company, for example, you have one domain name that is automatically assigned to that hosting account and is used as the primary domain name. Well, then any additional domains that you want to add to that account, Yes, it's basically a subfolder. That's right, Will. Within that main domain name, all of the add-on domain names are created as subfolders. Technically, they are also subdomains, but when somebody visits the website address, they are simply redirected behind the scenes to point to the proper folder on your web server. Overall, it's not horribly important to understand how that whole system works, but it's a system that was created a number of years back to allow multiple domain names to be hosted all on one web hosting account. And it was really just to reduce the cost of web hosting. I remember the days when you would pay $10 a month for every single domain name that you wanted to host, and you couldn't add additional domain names onto that account. When would you want to put a domain name in a subdomain rather than an add-on domain? An add-on domain is going to be used for completely separate domain names. So let's say I have registered a number of different domains that I want to build websites on. One could be downcomforterguide.com. Another one could be, something like electronicsuperstore.com. Well, these would be add-on domain names. The time when I would want to create a subdomain is when I would want to have an existing website have another section to the website that might be relational to it in one way or another and not justify using a separate domain name for it. A practical example when I use subdomains is actually for like my plugin websites, for example. I will often create a subdomain for a demo site, and this allows me to set up a completely separate copy of WordPress, and have complete control over the design of that website and not have it interfere with my primary domain name. So I'm just creating a secondary website as a subdomain, which I am linking to from the main web page because it is a demo page for it. But as you can see, a website like that probably would not have a good purpose for existing on its own. There's not really a need to go out there and register a completely new domain name just to create a demo site, for example, for a product that I might be trying to sell. Now, for Amazon affiliates, the only situation where I could really see that you would want to use subdomains would be if you get a domain name that you perhaps find that the niche is too generalized and you need to get a little more focused to be able to pick up the search engine traffic for it. Let's say you lucked out and you had the domain name electronics.com, for example. You could then create subdomain names on that site and have each subdomain target a specific niche within your primary domain. So then you might have a subdomain called TVs.electronics.com and another one called computers.electronics.com. And each of these could be completely separate websites, but then they would still, in one way or another, all kind of be tied together into the main website. And you could even link them up as such. So a subdomain is really just for use along with an existing domain that you have. Whereas an add-on domain is going to be a completely new domain name that you have gone out and registered and you want to build a website for it. Does that help to answer? Let's see. Do not need for every page you want to add on the main site. just to protect the main, right? Yes. The add-on domain names are only used to create the new website. You just do this once, and then your new website will be running off of that. And it is just a way to separate it from the main domain name, so people can actually access that from a separate location. Let's see, the next thing, oh, you're welcome, Stan. The next thing that I would like to show you guys how to do is to install WordPress. Now, I'm actually going to not completely walk you through two ways to do this, but I'm going to walk you through one way to do this, and then also briefly mention how you could go about doing this manually as well. Let me go back here. I think I jumped ahead of myself. Down here under Software and Services, there is an icon called Quick Install. Now, this may or may not be available on every single web host out there. If you are using HostGator, it should be there on their shared servers at least. Other hosting accounts may have something similar to this, even if they are not using exactly this Quick Install system. Some of them will just have a link here that says like site software, for example. On my dedicated server, for example, I don't have this Quick Install. I actually have another link that says site software, but it allows me to install the same type of stuff. And once I enter into Quick Install, you can see over on the left hand side here, there's all this different software that you can install on your site, and WordPress is up towards the top of this list. Once you click on WordPress, just click on this continue link right here, and then it will give you a drop-down box of all the different domain names that you have set up on your website. Now all you have to do is select the domain that you want to use. This box over here is for a folder. Now if you want WordPress to be installed in the base directory of a domain name, you simply leave this folder blank. However, if you wanted to install more than one copy of WordPress on this site, or perhaps you wanted WordPress to run in a subdirectory, then you would simply type in a name for the folder here, and WordPress would be installed to that location instead of to the base URL of your site. Once you've selected your domain, all you have to do is punch in a little bit of information down here. An email address, this is good to use a real email address here so you can recover your password for this website if you ever happen to lose it or can't access your site for any reason. The blog title will automatically go ahead and get set in the settings for this website, in the WordPress settings. So you can go ahead and set this here now, but if you need to go back later and change this, this is still available in the settings. You need to set a username for yourself here. I typically just call it admin, but you can also use pretty much anything else that you want to. Provide your name down below. Once you've entered in all the information for your site, all you have to do is just simply click on this Install Now link. Now, I have actually already installed WordPress on this particular domain name, so I'm not going to actually click this button here. Because it will overwrite everything that is on my existing website. But once you click on this button, it will give you a little bit of information and tell you that your site was set up successfully, and it will provide you a link to your site and also give you your username and your password that you can use to log into it. So once you click on this install button, WordPress is completely set up for you and ready to be used to start working on. You don't have to do anything else once you have installed it this way. So this is obviously the single easiest way that you can install WordPress. Now, if you ever find that you don't have access to Quick Install or any way to automatically install WordPress, you can still install it manually. To do this, all you have to do is to visit WordPress.org. This is their website for the WordPress software. The self-hosted version, WordPress.com, is obviously their blog where you can go and create a blog. But this on the .org website is the self-hosted version, which is the one that you want to install. Now all you have to do is just download the file for WordPress. This is going to be a zip file. You want to decompress this file onto your local computer, and then you're actually going to end up uploading that to the public HTML directory of your website. Or if you have created an add-on domain, make sure you upload it to the proper subdirectory for that add-on domain. Now they have a little guide here for a quick 5-minute installation, but there is honestly quite a bit of information here to go through, and can even be confusing to a lot of people that may not understand all the technical terminology that they have set out here. So I want to walk you guys just briefly through the steps that are required. I have put these steps in the ebook guide for this particular coaching session. So if you need that information, it is there for you. And I have also provided a link to this page that is open on my window right now. So if you guys need to get back to this page to take a look at this, you can. But simply enough, you just start out and you download the file and you decompress it on your local computer. The second step that you want to do is you have to actually create a database on your website. A little earlier this evening, you remember I was walking you through the database creation process through cPanel. You actually will want to do that exact same thing to be able to install WordPress manually. You first create your database, then you create the user for your database along with a password, and then you insert that user into the database and assign the privileges to them. Now, once you have created the database, you will want to then go and upload all the files and folders from the package to your public website. This is best done through FTP because it is a lot of different files and folders. You would probably sit there using File Manager. It would probably take a couple of hours to upload WordPress manually using File Manager because they only let you select a limited number of files at a time. So definitely use FTP if you ever need to do this, because you can simply select all the files and folders and just transfer them all in one fell swoop, and it goes much, much faster. Make sure you upload the files once again to the proper directory where you want WordPress to be located. If this will be in the base directory of your website, then you know, upload it to the public HTML directory or to the proper directory for your add-on domain that you're using. Now, once you have uploaded all the files and created the database, then you need to run the WordPress installation script. And this is actually done, it can be done in one of two ways. You can just simply visit your public website, and this will call up the installation script. Or you can also type in a /wp-admin/install.php. I've put that address also within my ebook guide. That address goes directly to the installation script, and all you really have to do there is just provide some basic information. You have to provide your database name, your database user, and the database password that you created previously. You put that information into the WordPress installation script, and then it will automatically set everything up for you and install it. It takes a little bit longer, obviously, doing it manually than it does automatically, but it's still not a very difficult process. You don't have to actually go through and edit files in most situations, at least. One of the next things that I want to talk about is WordPress cron jobs. Now, this particular subject can be a little confusing for some people, but I really find for it to be one of the most powerful features in terms of what cPanel can do behind the scenes. All the way down at the bottom here, you can find the cron jobs link. I'm going to enter into this just so I can show you guys an example of how this works. Before I do this, let me first explain exactly what a cron job is, so you can understand this before I proceed a little bit. A cron job is a way to have a website script automatically run for you at a specific time of the day or a specific frequency, like once an hour or once every day or once a week, for example. There are a variety of reasons why you might want to use cron jobs, but for, I guess, a vast majority of you that may only be creating WordPress sites, your cron job is actually something that is already in use on a WordPress site, but most people may not even be aware of this. Within the base directory of every one of your WordPress sites is a file called wp-cron.php. Now that is the WordPress cron job file that actually controls everything. But the only drawback to the way WordPress uses that file is that it requires your website to have visitors to it in order for that cron job to actually get called. So if you have plugins or themes on your website that are supposed to do something on a regular basis, let's say you have a plugin that is supposed to, you know, update advertising once every 24 hours for you, or maybe you're just creating the scheduled posts within WordPress where you don't want it published until a future date and a future time. Now, if you've ever done those before, especially if you've ever done them on a website that is not receiving daily traffic, you may have actually noticed that some of those things were not fired at the proper time that they were supposed to. Maybe your post didn't actually get published at the time that you had scheduled it to be published for. Now, the reason why this happens is because WordPress will only call that cron job if somebody actually visits your website. Now, this could be a public website visitor, or it could also be just you logging into the administration area of your website. But the bottom line is that if nobody is visiting your site, then this cron job is never getting called, and these updates that are supposed to be taking place on your site never actually take place. So the control panel's cron job system is a way that you can actually set up these scripts to run automatically without having that dependency of needing people to actually visit your live website. So to do this, you use this cron job page here. I'm going to walk you through a basic example of how to set this up. Up here in the common settings, you can see that there is a drop-down box provided here, and there's a whole bunch of different options, every 15 minutes, twice an hour, once an hour, so on and so forth. These are, as it says, some of the most common settings that are used for cron jobs, and what this is referring to here is how often this particular cron job that you are creating will be called on the website. Now, for the purpose of a WordPress cron job, I always set them up at once an hour. There is no point in setting a WordPress cron job to run any more frequently than once an hour, because it will not actually do anything any more frequently than that. There are ways that you can load code into WordPress that will be run once an hour, once a day, or once a week, for example, but you can't do any more frequently than once an hour. So this is always the setting that I use. Now, as you can see, when I selected this, it automatically filled in the rest of this information for me down here, so I don't have to worry about this. At a first glance, this can be a little confusing. But really, once you understand what this information means, it's actually pretty straightforward. Up at the top here, the minutes, for example, this refers to the minute within a specific hour or any given hour throughout the course of the day. With this set to zero, what this is telling the cron job to do is that at the 0 minute of every hour on every day of every month and on every weekday, then I want to be calling this cron job. Well, so if you wanted it to be called and run, say, at 10 minutes after the hour, all you would have to do is come up here and type in 10 next to the minutes. And this would have it run then every once an hour, but at 10 minutes after the hour instead of directly on the hour, for example. Now, another setting that you can use is, let's say you wanted it to be running every 15 minutes, for example. Use a star and a forward slash and then enter in the number that you want. A lot of these special settings that you may want to use, if you look in these drop-down boxes over here for each of the individual settings, there are a bunch of different options here that you can choose, which will automatically put the information over here for you to help you schedule these cron jobs in exactly the way that you want to. Now, the rest of this that you need to do is really pretty simple. Yes, that's right, Will. It will run only once every hour, at least setting it up the way that I have it set up on my screen here. Now, if I change this to every 15 minutes right here, this would run the cron job every 15 minutes instead of once every hour. So this would actually run once every 4 hours if you used these, or sorry, four times every hour if you used the every 15 minutes setting. However, if you were to set up a WordPress cron job to run every 15 minutes, it would still attempt to run it every 15 minutes because you set up the cron job that way. However, when that code in WordPress was actually being called, it would only actually do something once an hour, just because that is the pre-built limit within the WordPress cron job in terms of how frequently it is allowed to run. Okay, so to actually run the cron job then, you need to enter in a command for it. Now, the basic command that you use is just the word PHP. Now, what this is doing is this is telling the cron job that you want to run a PHP file on the web server. Now, the next part is you have to actually provide the entire full directory path to reach that particular file. And this is actually another one of the parts that becomes a little confusing here, because some people may not know exactly how to specify that directory. Going back here to the main page of my control panel, all the way down in the bottom right-hand corner here under account information, you can see that there is one item here that says home directory, and this actually gives you the base portion of the directory that you will want to use for your cron jobs here. And so what I'm going to do is now take this home directory back here and paste it in. Now, all this is doing right now, as it is on my screen, it is just pointing to the home directory of the main account on my website. So if I wanted to point to the public HTML directory on the main account for my website, then I would want to add the public HTML folder onto the end of this here. Now, if I had a WordPress site installed here, I could then simply type in wp-cron.php on the end of this, and this would then call this particular file right here, this wp-cron file. It would then call that file once every hour. But now, since a lot of people do use a shared hosting account instead of simply having a separate account for each of their domain names, with the add-on domains, since they are created as a subdirectory of your domain name, then right here after public HTML and before wp-cron.php is where you will want to enter in the directory name for your add-on domain, if that is the website that you are trying to set up this cron job for. So using the example before, the Down Comforter Guide site, I will simply type in downcomforterguide.com right here. As you can see, I have set this up as a subdirectory under public HTML, and then this will point to the WP cron file for this particular domain name and not for the main domain name on the website. Now, obviously, if you have a bunch of different WordPress sites, you will need to go through and create a cron job for each of them separately. You can't bundle them all together into one cron job, but it is okay to have multiples that are running on your site at any given point in time. So once you have punched in the information for your cron job here, all you have to do is click on this button right here to save it in your system, and then it will show up in the list down below here. As you can see right here, this is the exact same cron job that I have punched in up top here to enter. You can see the entire command here laid out for you. You can pretty much copy this exact command right here and use it on your own websites if you are using a HostGator hosting account, for example. The only two parts that you will need to change is right here where it says Fireboss. This would get replaced with the main username for your website hosting account. And then right here, you would obviously replace this with the directory name for the add-on domain that you are using. And then you should be able to use these commands as they are. Let's see, Stan is asking if the search engines see it's a cron job and how does that affect page ranking. No, the search engines do not know that cron jobs are in use. They can't even tell the difference. If you have a cron job, for example, that is automatically publishing content for you at a specific date and time, a search engine doesn't know the difference between the cron job automatically posting it for you and you actually logging into the website yourself and publishing the post on your own. All of this is just simply website scripting that is running in the background of your website. And so your visitors and the search engines never realize that it's happening. Does anybody have questions on anything that I have talked about tonight? so far, or even anything else with Control Panel that I may not have gone over, and maybe it's something that you are interested in learning. I don't have a problem even going beyond my planned content for these training courses and helping to teach you guys you know, exactly what it is that you're looking to learn. Will says, I notice you have PHP space before the file path for the PHPs. Yes, that's right. You do include a space in between the word PHP and the directory and the file name that you're actually running. That's separated with a space just so the PHP word here in the beginning of the command, this is the actual command that is being sent to the server. And then this is essentially a variable that goes along with this command to tell it which PHP file to run. As you can see, on this cron job page here, I actually do have some other types of cron jobs set up on this server, even though it is not a PHP file. For example, you can see this one right here. This is actually a Perl script. This works in a different way, but 9 times out of 10, I mean, if you're using the, you know, the WordPress system, it's not based off of Perl. Perl is another programming language, just like PHP is a programming language. So it doesn't use both of them. WordPress just uses PHP. Okay, that's okay if you need to you know, come back and ask some more questions later on after you get a chance to look over all of this. I don't have a problem in a later coaching session to, you know, go back and to revisit something for you. Stan is asking if there are some security steps that we need to know because of all the news he's been hearing about WordPress sites being hacked recently. Here's a couple of things to first understand about WordPress sites getting hacked. The security vulnerabilities that are causing these sites to get hacked is not something that is cPanel related. It's actually vulnerabilities that are within the coding for WordPress itself. And depending on the vulnerability, you know, obviously there may be a vulnerability that exists in WordPress at one point in time, but they obviously do realize when these vulnerabilities occur once they're released to the public, and then they do release updates to take care of that stuff. Obviously, that doesn't 100% protect your websites, but the most important thing that you can do is to always ensure that you are using the most up-to-date version of WordPress. A lot of times when WordPress sites get hacked, it's simply because they are using an outdated version of WordPress that still has vulnerabilities in it. So by simply upgrading, you can oftentimes wipe out a lot of those vulnerabilities. I guess another aspect to the whole site hacking thing is that on one hand, while it is possible for your WordPress sites to get hacked, the reasons why people would hack them are typically to just use them for spamming type of purposes. They might want to try to use your domain name and an email account connected with it to perhaps send out some spam mail, or they may attempt to load up some type of virus-style virus on your actual site to try to get that distributed to people that visit your site. Yeah, that is kind of part of it. Will is asking if I would say that they are overhyping it to sell security stuff. I actually do know one of the particular developers that has been selling one of the WordPress security products recently. I do not know the exact name of his product, but he has been selling them through webinars, and it comes with I believe it's a yearly membership subscription price tag. I do believe that while maybe not all of it is overhype, I do believe that a lot of it is, just because of the specific marketer that I know of that is doing that one particular system. I try not to name names of people, especially if I'm saying something negative about another marketer, for example. You know, I try not to publicly out anybody, but I definitely do believe that some aspects of the whole WordPress site hacking thing is definitely being overhyped to talk you into buying. Obviously, when it comes to psychology of marketing and selling products to people, they say that one of the most powerful tricks that you can really use is to, yeah, exactly, Will, fear of loss, the fear of things happening that you really never really know whether they could happen or not. But some marketers will definitely try to play up that fear and make you believe that if you don't do this, then it is definitely going to happen. That's right. It's basically like selling insurance. If you guys are keeping a regular eye on your WordPress sites, the number one thing that I can tell you to look for is once a week, for example, log in to the file manager of your website, or go through FTP, for example, and just look at the files that are contained within each of your WordPress sites. I have actually had WordPress sites hacked before, so I do know of an indication of what to look for, at least with some of those hacking tactics. And all of these happened, it's been over 2 years, I believe, since I had a WordPress site hacked. And I really don't even have a count anymore. I'd be willing to bet that I have over 100 different WordPress websites. My bottom line, besides updating your WordPress sites, Will, look at the files on your sites on a regular basis, say once a week, for example, and, you know, keep a mental note of when you are actually making changes to files on your websites. And then when you go back through once a week and to look at all the files on your sites, sort all of your files by the date that they were most recently modified. And if you can tell that one of your sites has had a file modified in a time span where you know that you have not modified that file, it's usually one of the biggest indications that something could have potentially happened with your site. Now, if you perform a WordPress version update, for example, it is going to then go through and update your files for you, and it will change those dates. So there are specific situations like that where it is legitimate that the dates will be changed. But in particular, look at your htaccess file and also the index.php file. that are in the base directory of your WordPress site. One of these two files is typically the file that's getting modified, because these are kind of the central files for the entire WordPress system. Whenever somebody visits any page on your entire website, whether it is a public page or the backend page, it is all going through that index.php file. So every single time that I have ever had a WordPress site hacked in the past, that index.php file was actually modified, and it was actually loading up coding on the site and trying to distribute essentially a virus, which would then try to steal personally identifiable information from people. Any other questions from you guys out there? If you have anything particular that you would like to ask me about using Control Panel, FTP, domain names, pretty much anything that I've covered tonight, or even anything that I haven't covered tonight that you may see in your control panels and have just simply always wondered, you know, what it does exactly. I'd be more than happy to go through some extra stuff here for you guys. I've got about a little under 30 minutes left for the evening, so I actually have a decent amount of time left here where I could cover some extra subjects for you guys. I actually managed to make it through all my planned content a little faster than expected. Could you clarify that a little bit, Clive? What do you mean by dot files? Are you referring to like the ending? Open the file manager. Let's see, I'll go in here for you. There's an option to tick dot files within the manager. Were you referring to the permissions that I was talking about earlier, or is this something different that you're asking about? Back one screen. Oh, hidden files. Okay. That's right. Okay, you're referring to the, let me do this again, show hidden files. Okay, the dot files. I got you. I didn't even realize that they were calling it that. The dot files, as it is calling it, these are the files like htaccess that I was referring to. Htaccess is typically a hidden file on your site, but it's actually a very important file, because as you may notice, when somebody visits a page on your WordPress site, for example, and they type in the URL that is going to your page, that page that they are typing into their address bar does not actually exist on the public website. All of that is being handled with programming on the back end. It goes through the index.php file, but then what the htaccess file is actually doing is it's actually redirecting specific types of URLs through the index.php file. As you can see here, I opened up the htaccess file, and what this is actually doing is, you can see, it has all of these rewrite conditions. It's looking for all of these specific conditions that can occur within the URLs of the pages on your website. And then it is rewriting all this, and you can see all the way down here at the bottom that it's rewriting everything to the index.php file, and it's sending along the additional information that was part of your website address as a variable to this index.php file. So what this does is it allows WordPress to use one central file to control the output of every page across the entire website. And it does it in a way that makes it more search engine friendly. You could simply avoid this system and just use variables on the end. For example, you can see right here the all of these parts of the URL up here. All of this, these are variables. All of the WordPress pages on your public site could simply be accessed using this type of variable, but instead WordPress will rewrite it into a search engine friendly way using just words for pages and directories on the site, for example. But then so your dot files are actually taking all of the accesses to pages on your site, and it is rewriting the URLs and directing people along to the proper location to show the correct content on your site. So when this htaccess file is modified, when you haven't made any changes to it, and when WordPress hasn't made any changes to it, if you update WordPress, or potentially even if you install a new plugin, for example, you can see on this side of mine right here that there was an old htaccess file, and actually fairly recently on June the 27th, it actually changed the htaccess file, and modifications were made to it. Now this was done because I installed a new plugin on this particular website, which made some changes to that file. However, if you have not done anything in terms of changes or adding plugins or themes to your site, and this htaccess file gets modified in any way, it could definitely be the result of hacking. And by simply making a couple of changes to this htaccess file, they can completely redo the way your entire website works, and even where your website pages direct to. They could actually add in a code to the htaccess file to simply redirect the pages on your website to pages on a website of their own, and then they would be free to load anything up that they wanted to there. All this again can be done through the htaccess file. This file, this particular dot file, and then also the index.php file. These are the two most important ones that you will want to keep an eye on to ensure that nothing is going wrong on your site. Yes, backups are the best way that you can protect against that, Will. If you have made a regular habit of making backups for your sites, and you do notice that something has gone wrong, you can restore your backup to then simply wipe out these problems. You would not need to restore a database backup. You would actually just need to restore your home directory backup, because in any of those hacking files, they will be modifications to the actual files on your website and not necessarily changes in your database. Did that answer everything for you on the dot files there, Clive? They're hidden just typically because they are important files on the website that the ordinary user will not be making changes to. And obviously, if changes were accidentally made to one of those files, and or if you accidentally deleted it or renamed it or something, then you could definitely see like that your entire website were to break. If you get a little curious, you can go into a WordPress site of yours and just rename the htaccess file to another name and try to visit your public site. It won't work as expected. But then if you simply return and rename htaccess to the proper name, everything will go right back to normal. You're welcome, Clive. Does anybody else have questions out there? Hey, Norma, I didn't even realize you were here. I'm just taking a look at my attendee list here to see who all is taking a look tonight. Good to see you, Norma. Hi, Norma. How do I work on a site before it goes public? When I'm building a WordPress site, Stan, I actually don't prevent the WordPress site from going public unless I have a really good reason to do so. When I'm building my WordPress sites, I will actually just build my content one page at a time. I will allow search engines to index the website even before I have completed building it. And my reasoning in doing so is that sometimes, you know, obviously if you're not sitting there constantly doing work on your site, it could take you a few weeks to actually put together a website. And so within that time period, you can find that a search engine will actually have a lot of your content already indexed. And the indexing doesn't happen overnight. So I just simply try not to put any obstacles in between my website and the search engines, for example, to keep them from getting indexed. So I will just build them. And obviously, if I notice that traffic is beginning to come to my website before I have actually completed it, I may try to make a few quick adjustments to it to make it a little more user-friendly. But 9 times out of 10, you actually get the website completed before you really end up getting traffic to it. But it can just shorten the amount of time that you end up having to wait after that until you start getting traffic. Okay, Norma is asking about how to use htaccess to protect files from being accessed by black hatters. There are some ways that you can do this, Norma. Honestly, my preferred way to do this is to actually any files that you want to protect from being accessed by somebody that you don't want to access them, the only completely foolproof way to protect those files is to put them outside of the public HTML directory of your website. You can set, deny commands, for example, within your htaccess file to attempt to keep people from being able to access those files. But honestly, there are ways that people can get around those, so it's really not a tactic that I commonly use. You can see over here in the left-hand sidebar of this hosting account that I'm on right now, I actually have all of these other directories here outside of the public HTML directory. These are actually directories that contain the programming files for different WordPress plugins of mine. And so what I will do is to actually load these files into folders that are outside of the public HTML directory, and then I will use a script that is within the public HTML directory to then retrieve these files and present them for download to the user. Now, when I get into the PHP programming session, which will be the fourth of five sessions in this particular series, I'd be happy to go through an example download script that would actually, I feel like, would be a good example that many different people could probably make use of. So I will be sure to make myself a note of that, and I will make sure that gets added into that particular tutorial, so you can see how to use a simple script to load up files that are located outside of your public HTML directory. And doing it this way, you can completely protect your files from being accessed by people that you don't want them to be. You're welcome, Norma. Glad to help. Let's see. Will is asking, to recap, backing up is the public HTML email database and the database. Yes. The different parts to it. Let me actually, while I'm in File Manager here, let me just show you real quick. If you're making a backup and you're actually downloading all of the entire home directory, as you can see, it will get all these folders that are here outside of the public HTML directory as well. But then you're on a hosting account that only offers a public HTML backup option. But then you also have an option to then save a backup of the mail as well. Now you can see up here there's actually a folder outside of the public HTML directory called mail, and this is actually where all of your mail accounts, and there are some other ones up here as dot folders. This is basically information for the applications, the cPanel based web email clients that you can use. So all that information is stored within the actual files here. Emails are not stored within the database whatsoever. And then obviously your database backup will be saving all of the content on your site, especially if it is a WordPress site, for example. All of the content is saved through there. If you simply make a backup of the public HTML directory and then also of the database, then those two things alone can be taken and restored or set up on a completely new website to duplicate that WordPress site. Everything within WordPress will be contained within the public HTML directory and also in the database. See, Stan said thank you for the great question, Norma. It was a very good question. I'll definitely be sure to touch more on that in the PHP session for this coaching course. I've got 10 minutes or so left here, guys, if anybody has any more questions for me. Didn't really intend to run out of my planned content quite so early tonight. The other training sessions in this particular series are definitely going to be a lot more in-depth, and I would really not be surprised if some of those later sessions actually run a little over the two-hour planned time. Clive is saying my go-to webinar invite for this training course and the Add to Outlook only added one day. I appreciate you letting me know about that, Clive. I was not aware that it did that. I set up this webinar series as a sequence of webinars, so you guys will only have to register for one, and then it would automatically enroll you for all of them. But obviously the calendar there, or adding it to Outlook, not adding all of the different dates. Is there a way to get PDF for the other sessions? I'll have access to a printer over the fourth holiday. Yeah, I will be sending out the PDFs for each of the sessions a little in advance of each session. I will try to get some of the other ones out to you guys maybe a couple days ahead of time instead of earlier in the day. But then again, like these ebook guides for this coaching session, this is not a pre-made material that I have put together. I'm actually going through each week and putting together each of these different guides for the upcoming week's webinar for you guys, because I asked a lot of you guys questions when I was getting you signed up for this, just to get an idea of what your experience may be and the type of information you may be looking to learn on this. So I'm actually trying to customize my training depending upon what it is that you guys are looking to learn. So in that regard, I do not have the PDF guides already put together for all the different sessions. Let's see, Joni said I didn't get an ebook guide. I just entered in the address for this into the chat box, Joni. You can download it by just clicking on the link there. Also, this link was previously sent out in the reminder email for tonight's webinar. I believe it was only included in the reminder that was sent out 1 hour before this started. So it's possible you may have missed that, but I will be providing a link within each of these sessions for the ebook as we go along, just to ensure that you guys get those. You're welcome, Stan. I know what you mean, Norma. I agree. Any more questions, guys? I got just a little bit more time left here. Don't mind answering a few more questions for you if you happen to have something in particular that you would like to ask, or anything else that you would even like to learn about control panel here. My just in case you did not take a closer look at the schedule for this series, just to go over this for you guys. The second course in this series is going to be next Tuesday night. It will be at the same starting and ending time as tonight's. And then the one after that will also be on the Tuesday following that. So those are the July 9th and July the 16th. Those are Tuesdays. And then the final two sessions are going to be on Wednesday nights, also at the same time, 7 p.m. And that will be on Wednesday, July 24th and Wednesday, July 31st. Let's see, Norma is asking if I recommend manual WordPress installs. She says I'm lazy and use scripts, but I hear they can increase vulnerabilities. I have never noticed any kind of difference between the two of those, actually, Norma. I often do use the quick install feature. However, I do not typically have those all set up within Sorry, I'm reading another question here. I typically do not have everything done through quick install. I've done a variety of both quick install and the other ones, but one thing that I will do is to not allow the global automatic updates. I don't know if that actually has something to do with those security vulnerabilities that you have heard that they could increase or not, but I would imagine that's really the only feasible thing that I can think of that would be different between an automatic installation and a manual installation. So I do think you are probably fine to use the automatic installations. Been doing them for years myself. Let's see, Joni is asking, how many domains do I suggest on one hosting account? Is it really unlimited domains? And should we be using multiple hosting companies? And what do I use for my 100 or so sites? I actually use HostGator exclusively now. There was a time when I used multiple hosting companies and have even tried a wide variety of them over the years. However, it really is unlimited domains on one hosting account, but the main restriction that they're actually out there targeting for the shared web hosting accounts, for example, that have unlimited domains, is they look at the resource usage that your sites are taking up on the server. So in those regards, you could have 10,000 websites on one particular hosting account, and they might not have a problem with it if those were not very busy websites. But then on the other end of the spectrum, if you had extremely busy websites, then they might have a problem with your resource usage with even only a couple of websites on there. So in those regards, you really just want to consider how busy each of your websites are and to try not to pack too much busyness into one single hosting account, because that's ultimately what will eat up your resources. I actually use a combination of both shared hosting and also a dedicated server. I've always used shared website hosting for simple websites like Amazon affiliate sites, for example. I just don't believe that there is any need to spend more than that. And I've easily put 30 Amazon affiliate WordPress sites on one shared hosting account and not had any problems before. But then again, it also just depends on how busy those sites are. On average, those websites may have received 50 to 100 visitors a day apiece. So, you know, any more than that, and you will want to decrease the number of sites on a single account. Let me show you one more thing real quick here, going back into the control panel, just to give you an idea. All the way down here at the bottom, under account information, you can see the server status. If you click to view your server status, you can actually see the amount of memory that's being used, the server load that is existing. These are the two main numbers right here that you want to pay attention to: memory used and server load. If your server load number right here is higher than the number of CPUs that are available on the server, then that definitely indicates that you are using too much in the way of resources. Your memory used should also always be under 100%. Thank you, Stan. The easiest way to clone a website, Stan, if it's a WordPress website, just make a backup of the home directory and make a backup of the database for that particular website, and then you can load it up on another hosting account or even load it up as a new add-on domain, for example, and that home directory and database backup will completely duplicate the WordPress site for you. Will, I don't put all of my PHP files outside of the public HTML. I just put the files there that I am looking to protect. Those particular PHP files that I mentioned, that's actually the PHP files for the different WordPress plugins that I've developed. So I will package up my WordPress plugins and put those bundles outside of the public HTML directory of my website. And this simply prevents people from being able to share links to my content, because there is not a publicly accessible URL that people could type in to a browser to be able to download my plugins. They are all protected by coding and a licensing system, and then it by having it outside of the public HTML, the only way to access those files through the public website is by going through the licensing system. So it's not that I put everything outside of public HTML, but just the files that I am looking to protect. But then obviously you need to have a way to pull those files up on your public website. Do I prefer having domain names separate from the host? Are you talking about like where I register everything? I while I used HostGator for all of my hosting needs, for example, I actually use GoDaddy for all of my domain name registrations, if that's what you are referring to. I do keep them all separate. It's not really that I did that on purpose or anything, but back when I was much younger, I registered my first domain name through GoDaddy, and so I have honestly just continued using them ever since. And I like registering all my domain names there just to keep everything in one central location. Just makes everything a lot easier. If I had some domains with one registrar and one with another one and so on, you know, it could definitely become a very confusing list there. Or if you have huge auto blogs. Yeah, that's right, Norma. I don't do the auto blogs, but I know that a lot of people do. Any more questions, guys, before I wrap this up for the night? I'm a little overtime now, but I don't ever have a problem with sticking around longer if anybody has more questions for me. And if you don't have any more questions, then I will be seeing you again next Tuesday night at 7 p.m. For the HTML coaching session. Any other questions before I call it a night, you guys? I appreciate all of you joining me for my Techie Masterclass, and I hope you have picked up something valuable from tonight's training. You're welcome, Clive. Thank you for coming, and I will be seeing you guys next week again. If you have any questions, you're welcome, Will. I'm glad you enjoyed it. If you guys have any questions in the meantime, before next week, feel free to contact me through my Facebook page. I don't mind at all if you're looking back through the ebook or watching the replay later, which I will have the replay posted for you guys either later this evening or early tomorrow, so you can watch the replay from this. But feel free to contact me on Facebook if you have questions before we meet up again next week. And thank you again, everybody, and hope everybody has a good night. And I'll see you all later.